So if you want to take notes, I would only write down what you don't see here. So, okay. Yeah, so so this SFT business, actually, maybe most people are not aware, started in December 1992. So it was in Basel, and I gave a talk. You remember this? So I gave a talk about the Weinstein conjecture, actually, my first talk. And then Jascha and I were running through Basel. And I think at this point, we already had an idea about contact homology. But it took then some time to go through with this. So now, So of course, there were a certain number of issues. So for example, in 1992, nobody knew even how to deal with the transversality issues in Gromov-Witten and so on. So then we knew that we should perhaps do some version of cylindrical, but it was always not particularly satisfying. So then in 96, and there were certain solutions proposed for dealing with transversality issues. And then I think at that point, it became clear that in one way or the other, you could do things, but it wasn't so clear if the methods would actually be so great. So I think so. In 2000, I was convinced that I could do SFT in 1,000-something pages in full detail. But right from the beginning, I had sort of the feeling it would be sort of the wrong methods to use. And if you have to write a lot of things and you're never convinced about the project, it's really hard. So then with Hotzke and Zehnder, we analyzed sort of what are the issues in SFT. And SFT is a really nice problem from basically every aspect you can think about it. Namely, it has a lot of analytical difficulties, but all the wonderful algebraic structure comes, in fact, from all the difficulties you see. So you can't say, you can, but you don't get very far. We put additional hypotheses, and some of the difficulties don't arise. And then we can do a little bit and so on. But if you want to do it in full strength, you have to deal with all these problems. And the problems and the analytical structures, it's sometimes quite tricky. So there's a lot to learn if you actually go into details. So then ultimately, when this was analyzed, so you could think of how would actually things have developed, so just as a starting point. Suppose a lot of the difficulties wouldn't be there, it would just be a Fredholm problem, and what would have happened? Well, if it just be a classical Fredholm problem, then people would have dealt with this like they deal with Fredholm problems. So once you take a small perturbation, and that's the end of the story, once you put that into this framework. And then, of course, certain things would have done which you don't find in literature, namely, when you have to deal with isotropy, you have to think about this. Then if you do SFT or this Flirt-type series, then you have a lot of interlocking or depending Fredholm problems. So if you perturb here in a particular way, then an infinite number of other problems have to be perturbed in a very particular way as well, and so on and so on. So I think if these technical issues wouldn't have arisen, things would have progressed differently. So, and now, how you deal with a classical Fredholm problem, if it's actually classical, is quite easy. It's not difficult. You just take a small perturbation of the section, and Sachs-Mehl tells you, when you set up properly, that you can make things generic. So when we looked at this, we thought maybe one can achieve this as well. So, but what are the problems? So the problems were, of course, that coordinate changes are nowhere differentiable, which of course is the reason why finite dimension reductions were introduced in the first place, because you reduce to spaces when you restrict that these transition maps, which are sort of canonical, are smooth. Okay, so then at some point then this project became, so once we found some kind of a setup, what was talked about last week, that you can generalize differential geometry where the local models are retracked, then this part of the project sort of got alive on its own. So we did differential geometry, but we also looked at all these cases which would show up when you would actually apply it to SFT. So that became one project. And there's another part of the project actually providing tools to put a concrete problem into this framework. And there we put also a lot of care into it. So these are all things which are nearing the end now. Namely, one of the annoying features of the analysis when you read any paper is that constructions usually are rather global. So everything is interlocking. I mean, analytical, topological, geometric aspects are all in this. And then, you know, when you have to write it down, you have to write a lot. So it's tempting to say one can easily see using standard method that that can be done, and you refer to some paper which refers to another paper, and if you follow this, it's not so clear what actually happened. Yeah? So therefore, in principle, when you look at elliptic theory, yeah, so you can make local estimates and just take a covering, and if you have estimates on this, the whole thing works. So in some sense, you want to have this kind of things here as well. So that also will work. So okay, so then, ultimately, which was almost forgotten, is that we started out from a problem, which now from this perspective is actually, I think, rather transparent. So, and I will talk about precisely how to deal with SFT, assuming that you would know this this polyfold language. I will explain the things which you have to know. And then, of course, because of last week's mini courses, I think you have an idea about a certain number of the ingredients. Okay, so here is a stable map. So I want to explain, so it's good to understand what that all means. So this here is a Riemann surface. The red things are punctures. This is a building. Now we use European notation for the floors. This is floor zero, because certain things later should have degree one. Floor one, floor two, floor three. So now, then there are marked points like this. Then these arrows here. So this shows you two half lines in tangent space. So if you have a puncture and a half line in tangent space and you fix a disk, then you can put coordinates on the disk which map zero to standard disk which map zero to this point. But when you have this line, you can map one in the direction of this line. So it completely determines what you have to do. Now, here, however, what I'm looking at is two arrows up to common rotation. Yeah, but you look from right and left, so they actually rotate like this. But so you look up to common rotation, and what you want is, if you take polar coordinates which are coordinated this way, and you run along, say, on S1 is 0, the r direction positive or the negative, they hit the same point on the periodic orbit. Yeah. So I do not. So let me say that to the SFT paper, there are some differences in this case. For the transversality, I do not number the marked points. I do not number the punctures. That gives more isomorphisms, which, however, have to be compatible. The perturbations have to be compatible with this larger set of isomorphisms. If I number them, then if I take a renumbering, I should perturb it in the same way. It's a little bit more complicated to keep track of. Yeah. So if you just throw everything away and do transversality on that level, that's one thing. Then for orientation questions, then you might go to a covering, which actually precisely means putting numbers there, if you want. So then...
I have no idea what you said the arrows meant.
So here in the tangent space, you take a half... In each tangent space, you look at half lines. And once you fix a half line, then if you fix a disk and take polar coordinates, yeah, so take a disk map and then you compose it with E to the something, then if you run and you take the disk map in such a way that the real positive real line in the tangent space is mapped to that line, that fixes precisely then polar coordinates. So now, but we don't fix them, but we fix them on two adjacent nodes, punctures. And they are allowed to rotate commonly. But the effect of this is then if you fix sort of a coordinated system of polar coordinates, one positive, one negative, then if you run along 0 cross R plus minus, 0, the 0 element S1, then they hit the same point on the periodic orbit. So now, if the periodic orbit is simply covered, there's only one choice. But if it's double covered, you have this one, but you can also take this by 90 degrees rotated and take the rotation class of this. So there are actually k many choices if the thing is covered k4.
So is it the same to say that for each puncture there's an asymptotic marker that you allow basically quotient under S1 action that rotates?
The two, common. Yeah. But yes, that is what you do. Yes, you have a common rotation divided out by the diagonal. So, but one you have to rotate multiplication by j and the other by minus j. Because of positive and negative. So.
Also, Helmut, are you talking holomorphic curved maps here or just maps?
This just, I'm not done yet. I'm in the middle of talking. So then here this blue stuff is what I call nodal pair. So there's on each is a pair one. There are two different points that could be on the same surface or the other, which you should think of being identified. So the maps will be continuous over those. And then here in square brackets, that is what is close to Katrin's heart, are maps. And these maps are not assumed to be pseudo-holomorphic. They're just maps. And then the square bracket around it means it's an R class. So because the image lies in R cross odd dimensional manifold, say with a stable Hamiltonian structure, and you have an R action. So if you take the map defined on these things here, and you just shift it by an R by a constant, it's also, so it's an equivalent thing. So this is the equivalence class.
You also quotient out by automorphisms of the domain, right? Hmm? You also quotient out by automorphisms of the domain.
No, not yet. At the moment, these are just, so, Riemann surface with all these features, then of course, at some point you have to do some analysis. So you have to be a little bit specific about what the maps should do. Yeah, so the quality of the maps is chosen so that you can do some analysis. So what I pick is H3 log, yeah, local H3 on this, and near the punctures, they should, if you take polar coordinates, should be of class H3 delta, which we have seen. So with exponential weight. And the exponential weights you pick have to depend, of course, on the periodic orbits. And in order to choose such possible weights, you have to fix an almost complex structure that gives you a linearized asymptotic operator, that gives you an asymptotic operator which is self-adjoint. And the non-degeneracy assumption means that if you look at the part concerned with a contact structure or with a hyperplane bundle in the stable Hamiltonian case, doesn't have zero in the spectrum. So each of those guys has a spectral gap, and you have to fix, and of course, since you have generally infinitely many periodic orbits, the gap might get smaller and smaller if you go to higher and higher periodic orbits. So for each of them, you have to fix something in the spectral gap. Oh, wait. Yeah. So
sorry, can you say again what the equivalence clauses mean?
Up to R translation.
If there is, what is our target here?
R cross V. R cross V. V is a stable Hamiltonian. Many for the stable Hamiltonian structure. So now, there's a stability condition, namely at least one. So each of these things here, so I think of this not being identified in the domain. So each of these things I view as a component of my Riemann surface. So then if you look on one floor, on each floor, there has to be at least one component which is not a trivial cylinder. So what is a trivial cylinder? A trivial cylinder is something like this here, which has a positive and negative puncture, which both are asymptotic to the same periodic orbit, and which is homotopic to a standard J-holomorphic cylinder.
Just homotopic?
Homotopic too.
So it doesn't have to have image R cross an F4.
No, in between not, but it's asymptotic to the same thing. So if it's homotopic to the other one, the integral u star omega is zero. So I write triddle because u triddle is a comma u, a is the R component, and the thing without triddle is the stuff in V. Then for connected component C, which is not a trivial cylinder like this one here, we have one of the following is true. Either the integral of u star omega is positive, or if it's zero, then you must have enough special points on C, which are the punctures, marked points, nodal points from the nodal pair, and so on. Is it clear what the object is? So this is an object in a category. So this here explains, so what this explains is the following. If you want to be precise here, you have to say that this puncture corresponds to this puncture, and you have to say that you have these two aligned arrows. Now, these two aligned arrows is, of course, you can give that by a complex antilinear map or a complex linear map if you change the structure on one side to minus I. So therefore, what you could think of is, if I look at the punctures and I take the tangent space, then I can take the real projectification of this. It's an S1, yeah, but not naturally, but it has a natural S1 action on it. So you have something like a principal S1 bundle over the punctures, yeah, and you want to have a complex, you want to have a, if you take the, take here the complex structure J and here minus J, you want to have a S1 bundle isomorphism, which gives you a bijection between the underlying punctures, and it says which line corresponds to what line.
Sorry, what is your J part of the data, or what?
J is, at this point, J is fixed, yes. What is J?
I don't know, you keep talking.
Yeah, okay, so, but I don't know even what you mean by J. There could be possibly two different J's. Katrin, there could be a J in the target, and there could be a J on the domain.
What are you actually fixing?
Okay. Okay, so when, okay, so I, can you just give me a little bit of a chance here to explain this? Yes? Okay, there will be a precise definition. But it would be good before you see letters, you know what we're talking about, if that's okay with you. Thank you. So, now, yes, you can, but give me at least a chance to finish this, and after this you can ask questions. So there in particular, if I look at the punctures, this would be the positive puncture of the floor called I minus 1 to the floor, negative puncture on the floor I. Then I projectivize the tangent space real with this structure, and here with the minus structure. And this would be a principal bundle isomorphism covering this bijection. So the bijection would say which puncture corresponds with what, and this would align the arrows.
Okay, sorry, can you explain what your letters mean? What is SI minus 1?
Okay, Katrin, bear with me. So now, this thing which we just saw can be encoded like this. This, of course, so we have a sequence of letters. The alpha I's is one floor. Negative punctures on floor number I. Si, remanent surface on floor I. Ji, the J on floor I. Mi, marked points on floor I, Di, nodal pairs on floor, so that would be horizontal things, on floor I, the equivalence class of the map, positive punctures. Then this one are precisely the ones which I explained here, which tell you how to align things in between.
Sorry, who aligns what? I'm trying to take notes here.
I just told you shouldn't, because this is online here. No, Katrin, this is online. Just open your thing and write onto the text, yeah? Okay? So, now.
Okay, so does anybody else still follow?
Yes.
Yes.
Good.
Yes.
So yeah. How about you tell me who matches what?
What?
I mean, it has been explained here. This, I think, is, it tells you which puncture from the lower floor goes to which. And above is the alignment of the arrows.
So V is a map?
Projectification.
And T is
a tangent space at the punctures of the remanent surface for this structure. Note here is a minus sign for the negative structure, and this is the principal bundle map. Principal bundle isomorphism.
And so where is that B in your next slide now?
In between. This covers that.
Well, right, but in the next slide.
Well, you see B hat?
B one hat implies B.
Is that supposed to be what's the previous? And that what? Told you how to attach alpha 0 to alpha 1?
Yes, that including the rotation, which lines are mapped to what, okay? Good. So what is a morphism? So a morphism, so this is an object in my category. So a morphism, I write like this, so here's a source, a target. It's a sequence of bi-holomorphic maps. So they gave from here to here, which means they map punctures to punctures, the negative punctures to negative punctures. On this part here, Si, Ji, it has to be biholomorphic. Mi is being mapped to Mi prime. Nodal pairs are mapped to nodal pairs and so on. And it should hold that if you there is a constant on each level. If you shift your Ui, then you get that composition. Yeah?
Sorry, what is the D again?
Nodal pairs.
Plus just means shift in the real direction.
Yes, that is on the, so for each floor, you're allowed a common shift of everything. Yeah, it's by adding a constant to the R component. Yeah, because we remember the objects were equivalence classes on each floor. Yeah, so that is. So these are the morphisms.
Does the morphism have to preserve that matching of the asymptotic markers?
Yes, okay, yes, it should. So if you, that's a good question. So if you have T phi I, it actually gives you, so it should map equivalent matching to equivalent matching. That's actually quite important. So for example, to answer this question, illustrate a little bit more. So if you have, suppose you have two double covered cylinders, so a building consisted of two non-trivial double covered cylinders. Then, so in particular in the middle, I have a double covered periodic orbit, and there you have these matching things. So now, this can be isomorphic, it can be isomorphic to a thing which has this shifted by 180 degrees, but this will be a different object. If I have an automorphism of this one, that requires that this matching is being preserved. So for example, if one cylinder is simply covered, but the break is double covered and the top is double covered, then this object only has trivial isotropy. Yeah? So if here is simple covered, a double covered periodic orbit and a double covered cylinder on top, this has only trivial isotropy because I have to preserve the matching. So I can't really rotate downstairs. But it's isomorphic to another object which has this 180 degrees. So in this business, it will be extremely important not to confuse being the same and being isomorphic, because for the counting things, because when you do in the fine points of perturbation theory, if you be sloppy about it, you start counting wrong things. Okay, so this is now a category, and clearly every morphism is an isomorphism because you can write down the inverse immediately by just reversing the order of alpha alpha prime and inverting all the biholomorphic maps. Now, what is not so clear, but which is a consequence of the stability condition in a nice exercise, is that between two objects there are only finitely many morphisms. So of course I call it groupoidal. So a groupoid is usually a small category which would have this property. I call it groupoidal because it's not a small category. But then this category admits a grading because I can talk about the top floor number. So if I just have a building of height 1, the grading would be 0. That means I only see the ground floor. If I have a building of height 2, the D would be 1. That would be the number of the top floor. So European notation. Then having this grading, my category decomposes. And let me artificially define what I mean by the boundary of the category. These are all S objects in Si for I at least 1. So then there's also an important point. There's also an important point, namely, if you look at the orbit space, orbit class of this category. So the orbit class consists of all equivalence classes of isomorphic objects. Then this is a set. Now you can build on Riemann surface lying in R3 or something, realize in R3. So it's clearly a set. Yeah?
So the morphisms preserve the matching, but not the asymptotic markings? Or?
The asymptotic mark is not here. So in contrast, as at the beginning, to what we write in the paper where we have the asymptotic things, we have them not only numbered, but we have markers there and we fixed points on the periodic orbits. We don't do that.
Then these half lines.
So that we had before as well, but we had on the top, our mark points were ordered, the punctures were ordered, and there were asymptotic markers at the punctures, which were assumed to hit a particular periodic point on the periodic orbit.
These markers are only punctures that are matched.
Yeah.
I'm confused about both what the question was and what the answer was.
No, he obviously read the book, read our... No, so what he asked...
I'm asking about the part, the ones which are marked in this setting. So you have these Bs which kind of match up with...
Yes, they just match up which puncture to what, and then the B hat is a lift of this. It just says it matches up lines up to rotation. And then if you take a holomorphic polar corners positive negative one adapted to this, then if you run along zero, in direction r plus to plus minus infinity, then they hit the same periodic orbit. It's the same point on the periodic orbit.
I think the question is just: does do the morphisms in your category have to carry this data?
Yes,
to this
yes.
So the B hat.
The B hat has to be preserved. So
not the choice of polar coordinates. Not necessary, right? So you could have just two arbitrary different choices would be automatically isomorphic.
So if you have two of these things which generate this class, then if you apply this morphism here, phi I minus 1 and phi I here, then it is mapped to a pair of lines which is that associated to the object, to the new object. Yeah?
Sorry, can I ask that again? Maybe differently. So let's say you have a morphism from alpha to alpha prime.
Mm-hmm.
Right, with two, each with two levels. So then there's one matching datum.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So if I fix my matching datum B for alpha, are there different matching data for alpha prime that I might have a morphism to, or is the matching data?
No, I just said if you for example take. So suppose this is double covered, yeah, covering number is 2, and then here I have something where a covering number is 1, let's say. Yeah, so this is twofold cover and this one. So then suppose I have this matching here, then obviously I have also a matching where this, where the one appears here, I don't know if you have colored chalk, but then you could so one matching is this common rotation. The other would be you put this thing on the other side. This common rotation, yeah.
Well, let's say I fixed my matching there, and now I have maps phi that take both the top to something and the bottom part to something.
Mm-hmm. Well, the something is some stuff which has already given a matching, so. The lower part maps should, if you fix two lines here, the lower thing should map it to a line here and the upper to a line there, which precisely gives a matching on that object. It's a different object. It has all this data. So it's not so difficult, Katrin. So if you...
Right, so question. If I fix everything in your morphism, if you go back one page, if I fix alpha prime... Right, let's say, so the phi I, if I fix the phi I, right, I fix phi 1 and phi 2, I fix alpha 0, b hat 1, alpha 1, I fix alpha 0 prime and alpha 1 prime. Does that determine b 1 prime?
So, okay. So the first thing is, in a given object, things would be fixed. So now if you want to talk about morphisms between this, you have to preserve this data. Now what you ask is, maybe, that if for my alpha, this is fixed, and I want to build another object, then of then in fact, what you can do is you can take different morphisms on each level, map it to something else, and adjust the marker so that this is isomorphic to the thing you started.
What I'm asking is whether the phi, together with the choice of source, determine the target you need.
I think the answer is just yes.
Yes. Yes.
The answer is yes.
Yes.
Okay.
So, Helmut, in this example, the top cylinder, it's just a trivial mapping cylinder, or?
Yeah, so, no, trivial. It's just something which is double covered. Yeah, so this would have an automorphism, and this itself as well. But as a thing with a marker here, the automorphism group is trivial. But this is isomorphic to a different object where this one, let's say, is rotated by 180 degrees. But that is a different object, has different data. Okay. Okay, weighted subcategories. So it's something like Facebook, like or not like, but with rational coefficients. So you look at Q plus between 0 and 1, which is just the identities as morphisms, so you look at a functor there, and you're interested in, and if I am given such a thing, then I have a full subcategory, which are all the things which I like to some degree, yeah, positive. And they are carrying a weight how much I actually like them. Yeah. So, example, given J triddle, yeah, which is an almost R invariant, almost complex structure R cross V, and are compatible with the stable Hamiltonian structure, we can talk about J holomorphic objects in S, which are the U's, yeah, the objects where the U satisfies the Cauchy-Riemann equation. So then define this by associating to pseudo-homomorphic the weight 1 I like and to other the thing I don't like. Yeah? So that's our modelized space, yeah? For the time being. Okay. So now the whole theory will consist of basically taking a partition of unity for the 1 and moving, now each point is represented by several which are fractionally liked, and moving it into a better position that each of the things looks like a manifold. So that needs, of course, some technology to do this. Okay. Good? I felt hope. Yeah, Katrin?
You said the... There was something about the aim.
You say
what the aim is.
The aim is, that is what I had said before it showed up here. So deform this into a theta with additional structures from which we can derive the data we need to construct SFT. So it turns out that you can later define thetas, you can define differential forms on these categories, and you can integrate them. So there's a really cool, nice theory for this. So, okay, aim clear. So now, so there's more structure here. So when I have an object in my category, let me define a different object, a different category P here, which consists out of the following. It consists of maps from finite sets into periodic orbits. And the morphisms are bijections between these finite sets so that is true. So this is actually already part, in some sense, of the data, namely, if I look at the positive punctures, I just take this points here as my point, as my set I. And the evaluation plus map is this map here, which associates to each of these points a puncture. And the same here, at the negative part. Now, this category might, for example, if the different points in this finite set go to the same periodic orbits, you might have different morphisms. Yeah? Yeah, for example, if I have 2 points here and they go to the same orbit, then switching the 2 points would be a morphism.
Is the point of all this categorical language just to keep track of isotropy? Is that the?
So in this category, I will explain everything to you, and then I will say there's a notion of a smooth structure on this category, and then after this, I'll explain a little bit that there are smooth versions of this like or not like functor. Yeah? Then once you have a smooth structure, you can talk about differential forms on this category. For example, the pullback by an evaluation map from a manifold of a differential form will be a differential from the category. And when you have orientations, you can actually integrate. You don't never have to leave the, so once you have a poly, so it will later called be a polyfold structure on the category. You never have to leave this. There are all kinds of universal constructions. You can do the whole transversality on that level. Yeah.
At this moment, you don't assume anything about this.
There's nothing.
No, I mean about the structure of periodic orbits.
When I make my definition, I assume that it was a non-degenerate form.
Not
Morse Bode. No. I haven't dealt with, and I don't want to. So.
So that was
discussed last week. So. So we have an odd dimension manifold with a stable Hamiltonian structure, and that defines the so-called Rebe vector field, and that has periodic orbits. Okay, so we have an input and output. Yeah, we just look at the restriction to the punctures. We get this map which says to which periodic orbit it goes, and then we can build chains like this, and it's called weak fibered products, and they look like this. So observe here that such a map BI, which we introduced before, this BI lies below the B hat. Yeah? So if you forget about the matching of the lines, is in fact such a morphism. So we look at chains of objects and these morphisms in category B. That is called, and we take the fibered product. Yeah. So we have an object. We map it forward, which would give the map which associates to the positive punctures of periodic orbits. Then we have a morphism from there to another such a thing, which comes from the next one, but going down. So we have here. These are not floors, so we have here different buildings. So these are objects in my previous category. I map them down, then there's into this category here, and there is a map mapping it to something which came from the negative evaluation. So note that this thing here, it looks like a new element in your category S, but it isn't, because the hat is missing here. We don't know, we don't have information how the lines are being matched. That is not there. That actually will lead to the fact that there is a relationship in our previous category, and this via some category, via some covering functor. Is that clear?
Excuse me?
Yep.
So it's clear, but I don't understand why you're doing it. Is it to describe the
Well, I mean, this is where d squared comes from.
But I mean, so you're saying that in the Becker structure you don't a priori have matching...
No, you don't. Because if you... No, in the boundary you have. But then now you have to relate it to the full category, which says if you have a building in the boundary, then you have to relate it to S. And in fact, how can you do this? Well, you chop your thing in the boundary, you chop it apart here. But once you do this, what does that mean? You just took a weak fibered product. You lose the matching condition. Yeah, because in this case, at the positive negative functions, I don't have, I didn't keep track of this. So now, in the original version, we had asymptotic markers there. So that information wasn't lost, but then you get a covering in the other direction because when you have everything marked and then you glue it together, you have to forget where you glue it together at the order of the periodic orbits. Then you get a covering there. So there's no free lunch here. But this thing where I take all the numbers away, all the orders away, has the advantage that I have a lot of morphisms. And my perturbations have to be compatible with this. They also have to be compatible in the other one, but there it's a little bit hidden because you have all this additional structure. And then you have to say, if I take here all the numbering away from this object, all the numbering here, they should have been perturbed in the same way. Why not just for the transversality, just take everything away, which actually is irrelevant for that? Okay? Okay, so now That is what we are looking at now. We take fibered products of lengths, so with two elements, three elements, and so on. This weak fibered product. So now S was graded by D, the top floor number. And now let me take multi-indices, yeah, with Ni is greater or equal to zero. Then if I, because I want to, so this has actually two filtrations, this category. So then I can talk about the norm of such a multi-index by just taking the sum of the numbers, and I can talk about the length of this.
Could you avoid this problem by taking this S to be like category with objects, you know, as they add the, remember these mark points, isomorphisms, turn the circle, and then two morphisms between the isomorphisms?
So you want to go to a two category?
Yeah, it has to be a two category.
I don't know. I didn't think about it. So then, given such a multi-index Si, I can obviously build this product here. Yeah. So these are degeneracy n0, degeneracy k. And then Sp can be decomposed like this. Yeah. And there is, OK. Now.
Can you say in words what that means, say, in terms of problem?
Yeah, you see pictures. I will show you in a second. So. So then there's a degeneracy functor which you can define on this by just taking the degeneracy of the objects. Yeah? And there's a length functor. We just look how long is that product here. So here's a picture. Oh, maybe. Okay, so here is how you have to understand that. So this here is a building in our original category. It has the top floor numbered 6. And I put a hat here. This is the BI, these are the BI hats. So now I get a multi-index 1002. So what does it tell me? It just says I should chop that into four buildings. And the first building should have top floor 1. The other should have just ground floors, and the other top floor 2. So that is a certain requirement on this here, namely, there should be at least top floor 6. So now I chop a building with top floor 1. Fibered product with ground floor, fibered product with ground floor, fibered product with a thing of this one. This organization is important for the perturbation scheme because you have to work your way up with all these compatibilities on this thing. So you have to know how you chop and what perturb what and so on. Is that clear?
So when I see a round dot here, I should think 1 trajectory.
About what?
Oh, what are the dots here?
The dots?
This could be a disconnected curve.
Where's dot? So this here, this is a building with height 7, top floor number 6. So this is like the first picture you saw, except that had less floors.
So if I just want to try and think how to prove d squared equal to 0.
No, you don't want to prove anything like this. It's a little bit early for this.
I want to know.
You will see that a little bit already.
Yeah, but the floors are kind of complicated. You could have many
Each of floor can be many, many things. Yeah. So, but it's sort of an easy procedure. It just, if you have enough of those guys, the right number here, and such a multi-index, so the norm is 3, the length is 4, and then you have to subtract 1 is 6, which is precisely the number here. So it's the norm plus the length minus 1. It's precisely this. Then you can chop in this way. If I get another one, if I put 0 here and 1 here, then I would have a ground floor here, then this here would be a building of height 1, of height 2, and so on. So there are different ways how you can chop this thing. Then the perturbation later, which you would see over this object, could be pulled back from this one in any other way it was cut. That shows you already some compatibility things. Yeah? So now, the notion of a covering functor. So finite covering functor. So you have two categories. And over each object you have, so it should be surjective on objects, and over each object you have lying a finite number of points. And this condition should be true, which looks a little bit difficult at the beginning, but it says the following. if you fix the source of all morphisms, like I fix, so I am interested in this point. I take a point which lies above it and look at all morphisms which start from this, which is this one, this one, this one, and here's the identity. Then this should be in bijection to all the morphisms which you see here.
And so you're writing your compositions with the source on the the source on the right and the target on the left.
What source on the source is I was writing like this. So this here is, okay. So this are the this is a morphism set of this category.
Right.
This is a morphism set of this category. Then it has a source map into D, and F goes into the objects. So it takes a fiber product here, and I do this. So now if you fix this point and take a pre-image under this covering, then if you look at all morphisms starting here, then you get a morphism to the object starting here, as a bijection to the object starting here.
What are the significance of your different typefaces? Because you've got italic typefaces, which are the categories.
Yeah, so okay. So this is maybe, I'm too didactical here. So a normal C would be the object, and this boldface would be the morphism.
Ah, well, that's what I wanted. So the boldface of the morphism.
Yeah, so these are objects, these are morphisms. Okay. Yeah. So forget about the definition. Actually, we already saw such a functor, namely something like this. And these are all functors of this kind. So take in your category. So we have our category S, we have the degeneracy index, and we have the evaluation maps. So now a covering structure for this consists of the following, and it's clear what it should be. For integers greater or equal to zero, Fij takes an element of degeneracy I plus j plus 1, and it chops it precisely at the right spot to produce a building with top floor I and top floor j. Yeah? So if I have a building of a certain length, I can say I chop it here, or I chop it here, I chop it here, I chop it here. So, and these are actually covering functors. So you can just take this definition from here to here. So that precisely satisfies the definition. So you see here already that in this formalism, you keep very much track of the isomorphisms, which is actually very important for counting later on.
Sorry, so the degeneracy is just the number of flows?
The degeneracy is the top floor number using European notation. So it's one less than what you would say the height of the building.
It doesn't count internal nodal points?
No. So then it's clear if I have something and I chop it here and then I chop it there, you could also chop it first there and chop it there, yeah? Which is precisely this thing here. So you have a chopping, if you choose the right indices, is commutative. Yeah? So then, using this rule, actually you can extend this chopping, and we saw already the picture, inductively for every multi-index. So there is from Si plus this product, there is such a chopping. So, and that is precisely this here. So if I take F1002, it is on S6, and it chops it in this way. Yeah? So these are all covering functors. Yeah? So you start with initials, so you can check, if you just use, forget anything else, just algebraic, these are all covering functors. Yeah? Created from a small list of covering functors, namely those guys.
You're writing equals everywhere, but you have a bunch of morphisms of categories.
That's actually equal. That's actually equal. No, just, you know, if you have three building with three things, chop it here, then I get a building of height 1, height 2, and then chop it here. I could have first chopped it here and then there. So that's precisely this identity. Yeah.
So is in terms of actual data, does the F simply forget one V hat and just keep track of a V?
Yes. So, yeah, what does this thing actually do? So this here takes the right spot in between where you have to cut that on one side top floor is I and the other J, and it forgets precisely the hats.
But only the one
at the right spot, which is determined by giving I and J.
That is what it does. You don't change the object, nothing. You just forget the heads for the B. Yeah? And that is obviously rather commutative. I forget here and forget there or the other way around. So. Okay, so if you look at the J Twiddle case, the pseudo-holomorphic case, you see that immediately. So this, if you have a building where each of the functions U is J holomorphic, yeah, if I forget the head or not, it doesn't change that the things stay holomorphic. Yeah, so obviously that's true. So now we come to some formalism, which is actually quite useful. So if I'm given such a Facebook functor here, and then let me define the boundary of this, is a restriction to the boundary of the category. So now, given this structure here, consisting out of this maps here, and then what I can build out of this, I can define that thing here. Okay, it looks a little bit complicated, and you try to understand this. Sit down. It doesn't say more than precisely that this is true for the theta, forget the J here. It's just the compatibility that if I pull back theta times theta by Fij, I get theta on the corresponding Sij plus 1. So this thing here, that this is equal, just means compatibility with these things here. So if you have a theta, you can obviously define a theta on the Fibert product. You just take theta of a Fibert product as a product of the thetas of the particular values. So it defines theta p. And then, here's a type here, should be a p. Sorry, here should be a p. Yeah? Then you pull this back, so you get to the boundary of the category. Build this sum here, and you want this condition. It just means that Fij composed with theta p is just theta restricted to Si plus j plus 1. That is what it means. So there's a short form. So this quality means high compatibility with this structure. So this is part of the conditions from which d squared equals 0 comes from later. Yeah? So it looks complicated, but it's a really short form to formulate it. Rather, otherwise, I have to say for all ij, this and this holds true. Just say that. Now, this formula occurs in a lot of ways. You can do a Fredholm theory satisfying this formula and so on.
Is this an inclusion-exclusion formula, that sum? What is the...
So model this thing that here should be theta sub p. You just build... You see, this takes values in 0, 1, rational. You just take the alternating sum, and that's the definition. And what you claim, what you require, what you say is compatible, is if so this thing is defined on the boundary here. Yeah? Because the Fi's come from an Si where I is at least 1. So this here defines a new functor on the boundary. And you say it's compatible if this is true. And this is a non-trivial condition, because when you look at this here, you take Fibert product of length 2, then you restrict it, so that theta is given. Then you restrict, then you pull it back, you get something on the boundary, and that was the supposed value there, and you work your way up. So there's a lot of compatibility. So but it doesn't say more than compatibility with the Fij's. So now, trivial cylinder buildings. When we do a perturbation theory later, or for the algebraic structure, when I have a modulized space of J holomorphic objects, and I multiply on each level, I put, say, the same J holomorphic cylinder in, I get a new modulized space, and obviously it should be the same up to that multiplication. It should be identifiable with the other one.
I was just trying to follow what was going on with the picture.
Yeah, no, I haven't explained the picture yet. I haven't even started. So when I do a perturbation theory. And for example, this building of height 1 would be pseudo-holomorphic. Then, so I would have this modelized space of this kind of things. Then if I multiply it by some J-holomorphic cylinder, yeah, that should also be in my modelized space. Because otherwise you never get the algebraic structures which you have. Yeah? So if I multiply it by several J-holomorphic cylinders, that should also be in the modelized space. It might have different signs and so on. So if I integrate over that modelized space having this, it should be basically like integrating over this modelized space, say up to sine, for example.
Can you just explain that beta formula again? The one on the last page. Like, suppose I have something with, like, you know, 3 levels. So there are various things you could assign to it. You could assign product of thetas of the 3 levels. You could assign theta of the first 2 levels times theta of the third. So what is the relation between all of these things?
If this is true, it just means that for the two for things, product of two things. Is equal to theta on Si plus j plus 1 for all ij. That is what it means. It's a convoluted way to say this all at the same time. But it's a good formula.
Can you explain the minus 1 to the length of I?
Yeah, so it has something to do with this. Suppose I have a function defined here and a function defined here, and I want to extend it over this. Suppose f is here and g is here. This is t and this is s. How do you? Well, you just define g of s plus f of t minus g of 0. You assume that they coincide here. That is a smooth extension of this.
So it's an inclusion exclusion.
Is it, well, I don't know. So if you do this now for higher things, you get this alternating sign. So that is precisely, you see, if you have this theta p defined, there are a lot of points where they have multiple definitions, but they coincide there. So if you write this down, you get this. So that's the underlying idea. Okay. So now, trivial cylinder buildings. So first of all, there are... So let me first say what a trivial cylinder building would be one. So if I have height 3 here, it would be, say, something like this, where top and bottom have the same periodic orbit, and each of them is homotopic to a standard J-holomorphic cylinder. That's a trivial cylinder building. And a J-holomorphic cylinder building would be where each of this is actually J-holomorphic.
So I just one more question about this theta. The theta is like 0, 1. Then to say theta on a building is 1 means it's 1 on each piece of the building?
So if theta is 0, 1, and there is in the product, so then if I have a product and one and both of them would be 1, then the building above, for where it comes from, would be 1 with the number 1.
And if any of them is 0?
Then it's not. Then it would be disliked. So, okay. So, in the perturbation theory, if this is a liked object, and I add J-holomorphic cylinders to it, a J-holomorphic trivial cylinder building, it should be liked as well. So in the perturbation, if I like this building, so here let's say J-holomorphic cylinders, and now I add a J-holomorphic building to this, then if this was liked, this should be liked with the same weight. That is, otherwise you never get any algebra structure. Otherwise, you can't get the multiplicative structure in SFG.
So these objects are different, though. I mean,
they are different, but in some sense, they have to count the same way up to sine. So up to sine. So how can we formalize this? if alpha and alpha prime differ by J holomorphic cylinder building, then theta value coincides. So here you have to notice that there is not a unique way to put a holomorphic cylinder to it, because you fix an equivalence class here and you have a map on it and you can shift it. So there's on each level at least an R parameter. Yeah? So that is indicated by this. But I think everybody understands sort of when I say add a holomorphic trivial cylinder to it. Yeah? But there's not a unique way, there's a family.
What do you mean by disjoint union sub R?
That is just explained. I just said that you add to alpha a holomorphic cylinder building, a trivial holomorphic cylinder building.
Is TCB a set or a
trivial?
Trivial cylinder building J holomorphic.
So it's a set of the J holomorphic.
It's just a line. If this building has height k, it's a line of k cylinders, which are holomorphic and trivial.
I know.
Yes, but there's not a unique way to add it to it. You get families. For each level, you get a family, an R family.
So the TCB there knows how many levels alpha has, and that's how many.
Yeah, so this is a short way to write it. So I add a trivial cylinder building to it, and then for any representative of this, because it's not unique, the value should be the same.
So I would write times R times the set of two cylinders.
What times R?
No, it's R to the K, because for every.
So if there's building of height 1, you have just a 1-parameter family. If building of height 2, for each of the thing you have a level R. So I'm just keeping it simple by this. Yeah, just add. So if I...
So whatever this symbol means, alpha disjoint union TCP, it's a subset of your object category.
So here I add I would add 1 trivial cylinder, but even here it's already not unique, because here you have an equivalence class of maps. So you have to choose a representative, take this to this, and divide out by the R action, and you get an R family. Then if I have another level, I do the same. Okay, so my requirement is that theta should have this property. Then, if alpha contains a trivial cylinder building, which is not necessarily holomorphic, but if theta of alpha is positive, then the trivial cylinder component are all J holomorphic. So on that level, it's a little bit more complicated to formulate than later on a linearized level, where you can actually write down some functors, and then that's true.
So, okay, sorry, let me ask this again. So when you write TCB, really you mean to just put one chain of trivial cylinder?
Right, yes, and then you can do it again and put another chain to it and so on. And... So if it contains a trivial cylinder building, which might not be J-holomorphic, but if it's liked, then the trivial cylinder components are all J-holomorphic. Okay? So these are properties.
So just actually, yeah, you used up your time, I think, so if you want to say...
What?
I know it flew by for all of us.
When did I actually start?
We started at 30 after.
So if you just want to finish up very briefly in another minute.
Yeah, let me.
You have other lectures coming up this
week. I know, but this is frightening. So, time-wise. Okay, so let me just... So now I'm using a theorem of Joel Fish. So give me a few minutes here and then I'll stop. So so if you have... 2 non-trivial components. Each building level has a non-trivial component which is not trivial cylinder-like. Then you can move them against each other, creating again a family on each level, yeah, an R family. If you have several components, you can move them against each other. And what you want is, if you have 2 stable, so if alpha and alpha prime are stable, and you take sort of this union of things, yeah. So on each level, you're allowed to shift them against each other. Then the theta of alpha should be the product. Yeah? So you have to think of this. Theta, in some sense, would say find pseudo-holomorphic things. And if it's pseudo-holomorphic and it's disconnected, yeah, on each level, then each thing individually already existed and was perturbed and so on. OK, so summary. Okay, so then I'm stopping. So we are interested in deformation theta of theta twiddle. This is the original functor which identified J holomorphic objects. We want to deform it to a theta, having the following properties. This is true. Then this is true if we add just a trivial holomorphic cylinder building. If this is positive, then this has to be true. Then this thing actually had to be pseudo-holomorphic. And if I have stable things and move them against each other, this has to be true. So SFT algebraically comes from this. That's all there is. Okay.
Do I understand correctly? This is more or less the same as saying the whole theta is determined by the value of theta on one Floyd thing with one connected component. Is that a true statement?
Yeah, that's a good one Floyd. Okay, so let me not buy into this here. So so I have to look at the algorithm. So the algorithm is a little bit. I will give you the algorithm how to perturb. Yeah. So the algorithm, bit precisely, yes. So in the first time to perturb, you have disconnected objects. So in the hierarchy concerning some complexity or energy on the bottom floor, where things cannot degenerate further, there are disconnected things. Connected things, which you perturb. Yeah, it comes from there.
All right, well, why don't we thank Helmut for his talk today?
So that is what I wanted to do in the first 15 minutes.
You know? So slow.
All right, so are there any brief questions for Helmut?
Yeah.
So I'd expected you to write down a brief list of axioms in which all but one were manifestly satisfied by the sort of defining property for the pseudo-holomorphic case with which you start, in which you just assign one to holomorphic things, and the other would be the thing you need to achieve by the deformation. Is it easy to
decompose? So if you take this properties here, you would see immediately that they are satisfied by the pseudo-holomorphic.
Precisely. So yes. Somehow. So I mean, but of course we don't want to just take the trivial deformation. So you want deformations which satisfy these plus something.
Okay, so that's a good. So my as we were just reminded, I have four lectures. Of course, it's not so clear if I get to the very end of it. But at this point, what we have done is I have sort of in this category setting said what things should do. Okay, so now the next thing is, there's a notion of a smooth structure on a category, but you can only do this for when you have this polyfold theory, because other things you cannot do smooth. Then you can start talking about smooth objects of this kind. And smooth objects of this kind, so these are sort of smooth sub-categories, and what are they? So they actually occur in different flavors. There are manifold type, orbifold type, branched orbifold type, and so on. And these things then will be constructed by Fredholm theory. So you can transpose these properties into the language of what you should do on the perturbation level, on the linear level. And there's a nice functorial description. So this is obviously sort of functorial here. This is a little bit odd, but there's a nice formulation on the linear level for this. And then you define a bundle over this. You have the Kusch-Riemann section functor, and you want to perturb that one. And then that is how it looks like at the end. So you have, so this is basically over each object here, the fiber are the 0-1 forms along the underlying map. So here you have the Kusch-Riemann functor, and then you define something like this Facebook thing here, but it's a section. It delivers on the fibers, and it associates to each fiber to a certain number of points, a rational number, adding up to one. And then this here is your theta, if this is properly chosen. If you put here theta zero, which just is the zero, which just gives the weight one to the zero section and to everything else zero, then this here is actually our theta j twiddle. So if this here is theta 0, which just puts weight 1 on the 0 vector and weight 0 on the other, then this gives you, this composed with this gives you that one which you already saw. So here is a small perturbation of this. And since in the fiber everything adds up to 1, what you literally do is you take a partition of unity for your theta j triddle for each object, and then you move the objects, now you have several ones with fractional weight, in different directions, and they line up to manifold pieces locally. That is what you do.
All right, so I'd like to make sure everyone has enough time to get enough coffee. So I think we're going to cut it off here. If you have any further questions for Helmut, he's around. And we will attempt very strongly to meet back here at 11 for the next talk. So let's thank Helmut one more time.